gets the okay from the referee.
What saves? Is it no? Ryan Peterson saves it, and it dribbles over the line.
0-0 after 90 minutes. UWC win 4-2 on penalties.
Jasper Loy! Great goal, eventually scores! Corner, oh, that's gone in! Confusion between defender and goalkeeper, so Chandler's got a man!
Football 2016. We move right along into the second round of this year's competition, and it starts right here at the Bidvest Stadium. It's Wits University up against the defending champions, the University of the Western Cape. Well, we are very much in the middle of a cold front, and that means it's been an extremely cold Monday. There is the extra threat of lightning and thunder, which means we could very well see the start of this game pushed back a little if the officials feel that the safety of the players is under threat. But we'll keep you updated as far as that is concerned. We are, of course, at the University of the Witwatersrand, founded in 1922, and it really needs a very little introduction as far as the academics and the sporting scene is concerned. But it is, of course, the football matches that we are concerned with here this afternoon as we get start round two of varsity football. A very, very warm welcome to your World of Champions, across your World of Champions to all our viewers as we take a look at the familiar sights of Johannesburg. My name is Luazi Sekubu, and once more I'm delighted to bring you varsity football action, and once more I'm joined by Umotu Huling Gininda. Mo, thank you so much for your time. And before we talk varsity football round two, let's quickly have a look at what happened last week. A fantastic start to the competition. 13 goals scored in 4 matches, including, of course, that 8-goal thriller in Mafeking.
Yes, Luazi, last week was really amazing. The team were really competing for the number one spot, which is the first game of the tournament. Everybody competed. You saw UJ emerging 6 goals after Northwest was leading 1. So all these teams that are here, they've shown that they don't want to add numbers in the tournament, but they're here to compete as a university. So I am really looking forward to a good second round of varsity football.
Well, of course, this is one of 4 matches that will be taking part throughout the afternoon, as we see the sides there. Just having a look at the conditions, it really is bitterly cold here at the Bidvest Stadium, and there is a fair bit of rain as well in and around the stadium. But again, we'll keep you updated as far as the weather conditions are concerned. And well, the University of the Western Cape, they are visitors, and the coach earlier on when I spoke to mentioned that they brought the Cape Town weather with them, because this is something that we don't normally see in Johannesburg, Mo.
Yes, looking at this weather, it favours UWC. If the game starts with UWC going slow, they'll definitely feel the heat and the discipline of Best University in the field of play. So this favours UWC right now. They need to take the game to Best as this weather allows them. This is what they live in, and this is what they can actually compete on. This weather favours them 100%.
Well, it certainly does. But before we continue talking about the first game of round two, let's quickly have a look at what exactly happened after round one of varsity football. And it is the University of Johannesburg right at the top of the log after their impressive 6-2 victory over Northwest University Mafeking, joined by CUT and TUT on 3 points. And it means the rest of the log, as it stands at the moment, are still searching for their very first victories of the competition. And that includes our two sides here this evening, Wits and UWC. lying there on a point and 0 points respectively. And Mo, just before we quickly hear from the two coaches, I want to talk a bit about the University of the Western Cape. We talk about how difficult this competition is going to be and how strong the field is. What do you think, what type of pressure do you think the defending champions are going through right now?
Look, UWC has so much pressure because the squad has changed a little bit, with some of the senior players having to graduate and some of them obviously getting the overseas scholarship, as the coach was indicating earlier on. So all I can say is that the remaining team will compete as their defending champions. They wouldn't want to disappoint the Cape Townians that side. They definitely want to leave this side with a 3 points.
Well, speaking about disappointing, Vitz, I'm sure don't want to disappoint their home fans, as well as the coach mentioned when I spoke to him and his counterpart a little earlier on. Coach, thank you so much for your time. Now, it would have been an extremely frustrating defeat that you guys suffered last week, suffering a last-minute defeat to TUT. How have you guys gone about making sure that you focus for the full 90?
Well, I told the players to stop focusing on the external factors. You know, those could be the fans, the referee, and the atmosphere, you know, the varsity football atmosphere, basically. I told them to focus on the basics, to focus on the play, on what we are in control of, you know. So I think they took the defeat badly, but we managed to get them back, you know, to focus on the game today. And I think today they're a little bit more focused, especially at home. They have to be focused at home. I mean, we've got 3 home matches, so we have to be a little bit bullish about our approach and try to get maximum points at home.
Now, you're up against the defending champions, a side that knocked you out of the semi-finals last year. In fact, it's a side that you found very difficult to beat over the past couple of years.
Yeah, 2 draws last year. Actually, and another draw this year at the USAS. So, and both we lost on penalties, you know, quarterfinals at the USAS. Last year it was the semis. So, yeah, the teams are a little bit, I think, evenly matched. But what we are at home, as I said, today we have to approach the game a little bit more different. You know, we have to go more attack. And to be fair, both teams are in a rebuilding phase. You know, you look at their team and our team. I mean, we have something like 70% to 80% new players, because the others have graduated or left the university. You know, so all of us are rebuilding. We'll see. It's a totally new side from the UWC side, and a little bit more different as well from us. So, yeah, as I said, we have to think positive. We have to think of attack, all-out attack. Obviously, a little bit more guarded at the back, so we don't concede stupid goals, so to speak. But, yeah, evenly matched, the two sides. You can say we a little bit worried that they also brought the weather with, you know. This is Cape Town weather. But, yeah, we'll deal with these. These are external factors. We have to focus on what we are in control of, as I said.
Well, all the best for tonight.
Thank you, sir.
Coach Sully, thank you so much for your time.
Welcome, everybody.
Target on your back as defending champions this year. And amidst all the talk about this being the most difficult field that's ever been presented by varsity football, how much pressure does it put on you as a defending champions?
I don't think there's much pressure on us. You must realize that we're just out there to play, and the students are there to perform. We obviously in a very nice situation where we have some of the guys who played last year. But we also lost a lot of competent players due to graduation and obviously other reasons. Some of them went overseas on scholarships. But we are quietly confident of giving good performances and hopefully getting the results that we deserve.
And last week you had to come from a goal down at home against the University of Pretoria. How important do you think it's going to be to show that type of character and resolve against some really tough opposition?
That is one of the things that we work on. I especially try and get the players to focus and to think about, you know, the difficult opponents we will be encountering. But one of the things that the players do have is that they have the quality to really just buckle down and stick to the task at hand. Yes, the opposition for this year's Varsity Cup is quite tough, but with the new players that we have, I think we've got in some quality youngsters, especially first years. In our squad of 28, I think we've got about 16 first year students, and it augurs well for the future. Hopefully this year we can defend our title with some good performances, and I'm just hoping that the youngsters can come up to the task especially tonight, conditions is a little bit tough, but I'm sure they're up for the task today.
All the best against Wits.
Thank you very much.
Well, historically, this is a fixture that favours the University of the Western Cape. Question is, will that continue to be the case? And Mo, quick prediction on your side, who's walking away with the 3 points?
Wits will be taking the 3 points. Actually, it will be remaining with Wits, the 3 points.
Well, Mo is going with the home side. We'll see exactly what transpires in the next 90 minutes. We're going to take a bit of a short break. When we come back, we join our commentary team, Cesar Mabena and Grant Bissett, as they take us through the first 45 minutes. Wits up against UWC.
It only took a single evening of explosive Monday night action to remind us exactly why we love varsity football so much. Now we're back for round two. The University of Witwatersrand take on the University of the Western Cape in what is the first of the fixtures taking place today. Well, whoever's in charge of the weather must have heard us speculating about a delayed kickoff if there's any hint of thunder or lightning. It's gone away. In fact, the sun has been able to peep out of the crowds just a little bit. We're under floodlights right now. But there's a little bit of natural light as well as these young men take to the field. And as is always the case when it comes to varsity football and youngsters trying to split their attentions between football and furthering their educations, there needs to be a shift in focus. And of course, for today, the classroom is replaced by the change room, tactics replace tutorials, and they will be going from studying textbooks to studying the opposition team sheets on this chilly afternoon. They'll be looking to get good grades, or rather to get good goals and not good grades. We're about to hear the national anthem as sung by Parktown Girls High.
Ooh.
yourself a pat on the back, ladies of Parktown Girls. Ah, it's not often that I rack my brain for superlatives to describe anything other than football. And even to my untrained ear, that was rather pleasant. Hopefully it's a precursor to an excellent match here. And ensuring that it is excellent will be the 22 men out on the pitch. We will take a look imminently at the lineup for the home side today, the University of Witwatersrand, and exactly how they will be lining up. It is Brian Peterson between the sticks. Kaiser Mbanga will anchor the defense. He's also the captain today. And then look out for Matonzi in the midfield, the youngster who started playing varsity football when he was only 16 years old. Wearing the number 15 jersey, he scored last week in what eventually was a game that they went on to lose. Lining up against them, it is UWC Ahmad Seris, we are familiar with from the multi-choice Disky Challenge, is playing right fullback today. Brent Lehman is in between the sticks, whilst the captain Josh Silent up front will be looking to bang in the goals. Sohail Ali scored last week. That means he retains his spot out on the right-hand flank. Well, with those formalities out of the way, it gives me a chance to introduce my guest sitting alongside me, Sizwe Mabena. We've had the opportunity to watch the first week of varsity football. We're into round two, so we kind of know what to expect, but it's always going to serve us up something interesting.
Well, the beautiful thing about that, Grant, and I thank you very much to you, of course, for the introduction. But the beautiful thing about the results from last week is sides are now under pressure to look for their first wins of the campaign. That goes for both these sides and, of course, this meet here. And, in fact, being at this venue takes us back to the very first varsity football coverage 4 years ago on that very first day here on your World of Champions. Then it was UWC, or rather the NWU that were visitors rather than UWC. And, well, they've come a long way. This university from those days, of course, having reached the semi-finals last time out. And that said, from that first year, UWC themselves have done rather well in being crowned champions last year. So there's been a marked improvement in both varsities. Looking forward to a great game between sides under a bit of pressure. There's still time, but they'll want to get that first win out of the way.
Well, what we're looking at right now is not the pre-match meal. Yes, it is being delivered onto the field by Debonair's Pizza, but this is the match ball. Will be received by Abraham Mashala. And just while we're on the topic of officials, assisting him will be Happy and Tlantland, Sean Olive, the touchline officials. So here it is, the match ball being presented to the referee. I like this little touch.
Oh, it's a beautiful touch. Never seen it done before in any platform. Keep in mind, we on your World of Champions have just recently shown you the Euros. We've seen AFCONs. We've seen World Cups. Nothing like this before.
Well, they had a motorbike in Mafeking last week, so not quite as flashy as that. But it will be the captain of UWC, Josh Silent, the very burly 21-year-old from Klerksdorp, who gets us up and running here as the men from Cape Town play from left to right in an almost all-white kit. So, well, it's a blue shorts and blue socks with a little trim of yellow. Of course, Fitz playing in almost full yellow. They've got a trim of blue and a hairy moment. Right from the onset, going back to the goalkeeper, Arlen Peterson, new in between the sticks this week. Almost a horror show from the start. Kaiser Mbanga, expect to see a lot of him, the captain, forming what seems right now to be part of either a three or five man defense. We wait to see how far advanced the fullbacks get. Knocking it around neatly here, and good skill shown by Gilbert.
You mentioned the defense, Grant, here. Yes, in the team list they gave us is three at the back, but I'm expecting Luke Pereira out wide on that far side in the midfield to drop into a, well, wing-back sort of position, so dropping back into a right-back position, and the same for Gilbert on this near side. We'll be keeping close tabs on him to see how far back he drops, of course, in the defensive side of the game, but it'll be interesting to see how they execute this formation, Wits. Almost said Bitvis, Wits, but it's Wits University in this case.
Well, we were talking about that pre-match. It's a little bit difficult. We're here at the Bitvis Stadium. We're sitting right here, and you might feel inclined to call them Bitvis, Wits. It's not, of course. And their nickname isn't the Clever Boys either, if I'm being informed correctly. It's Witsies, but... well, this free kick won. Josh Silent, the big man, going down. Hoisted in, flat ball, and pretty difficult to deal with. Sean Olive has signaled that it will be a goal kick, so they have big men up front that they can aim for, and I'm not talking big simply in terms of their height. Look at the size of some of these young lads, Zohar Ali, Josh Silent, who I've mentioned already. Like bodybuilders.
Yeah, looks like an intimidating figure to Suhail Ali. I'll love to see him, of course, in the attacking end of things. And when it comes to set pieces, they've got great height about some of their players to the men from UWC.
Well, Ahmad Seri's getting into really advanced positions. Now, he did lose out, and he'll have to be very careful not to get caught out in those advanced positions. He's someone I did mention already that we are familiar with, plays for the Ajax Cape Town team that competes in the multi-choice Disky Challenge. Of course, Ajax Cape Town have youth structures that go all the way down, if I'm not mistaken, to under 12. And they have a reserve team, an MDC team, as well as an ABC Motsepe team. And many of these young lads actually playing for those outfits.
Mentioned the height of the young men from UWC. In fact, we should see great aerial battles on either side of the field here. Up front, they do have the likes of Gilbert and Dore to
Dore's
the University team. Yeah, Dore's got a great presence about him. So in the attacking end of things, he'll be interesting as well as the dead ball situations. They've also got Rugato in the back three. It'll be interesting to see him push forward, of course, as one of the tallest out in that field.
Both teams have been knocking it around fairly confidently so far. That's a great interception by Seri's up to Silent. Not the best chest control. It got away from him just a little. One thing that might be quite interesting is we see Graham Dore get onto the end of this. He's showing great strength for a rather lanky young lad. Only 19, hasn't quite filled out to his full potential, you would imagine.
Was met well in the battle then, in the battle for strength by Swatch.
Oh, that was a crucial header away because Dore was waiting. Now Suhail comes back to help out. Throw in here, back into play now, turns it into the area. That's what they'll want to see more of, because there was Dore waiting. He is quite a presence, as you already mentioned, Cesar. Whether or not he's getting his head to the ball or not, the defense is always worried that he might. Where is he? Is he lurking around? Because it's going to be difficult to beat him in the air.
Well, what was interesting there, yes, he did lose out in the aerial battle. He didn't have to get his head onto it. His teammates have been well drilled, though. It's all about picking up the second ball or the drop of the ball from then on. They did, in fact, pick it up. They had numbers around him. They weren't able to make use of that situation. But if he isn't to win it in the air, what's important is that second ball for the men surrounding Dore.
Oh, that's coming forward. Dore leaves it beautifully for Gilbert, who takes it from range. It wasn't struck with enough ferocity, and you imagine if it hadn't taken the deflection, it would have been rather easy for Brent Lehman to actually pick up.
Wondered about Gilbert's presence on the team. Yes, they have him out wide on the left side. He's drifting in field. He's amongst the attack-minded players, meaning it's been left to Siakheng to drop back into the left-back position.
Oh, takes a shot. And you wonder whether maybe he was trying to just hoist that into the box, or whether he was going for it. If he was going for a great presence of mind, my word, that is a special effort there from Siakheng. And it had Lehman stretching.
Man in question. as we were just talking about him, steps up to have the most positive moment of the match so far. Well met by the goalkeeper. Now, we spoke about the aerial battle between these two sides. Here's the first real test.
Here it comes, corner number one. It's hit rather flat. Only makes it as far as the near post, although it does find the head of a teammate. It could be a chance to reset and get something going. It didn't quite shape up that way for them.
Wasn't a bad set piece. It's something they would, that they'd worked on. When you consider the man that met it in Mapanga is amongst the tallest out there. What he did do wrong, though, he went through the motion of the header a little too early, a fraction of a second too early. So when the ball met him, it was more a clearance than a header towards goal.
And really got the meat of the ball hit square with his forehead from that near post angle. You want to be flicking it on, or rather flicking it towards goal, just touching it and changing the direction. I was a little bit lucky for Sahail there. Wasn't the best touch, but it came for a teammate and then over the top in the direction of absolutely no one. Josh Silent will be a little bit upset with the ball from Kukwanda. Speaking of Josh Silent, I saw say just a little over a week ago before Varsity Football began. Now this, they of course are the defending champions. He's the captain. Went around Cape Town showing great strength. There is the man in question. Went around Cape Town delivering debonair's pizzas to all of the Cape Town based journalists. Again, we speak about nice touches in Varsity Football. They had attention to detail. That's part of it. Now chest strap into the path of a teammate, and what a fantastic save by Brylan Peterson. Charging in there, Kukwanda.
You mentioned Josh Silent, he was vital here. The long ball saw him chested down, and well, the movement around the big man is what's key again in forcing the opening in out and out play. First corner from UWC, their best moment, and their captain, who's got the physique of a rugby player more than anything else, using that size well.
Now we see what they can do from a set piece such as this. Again, hit flat, that's been the story of the day. No one trying to whip it or curl it in so far. Silent using his strength. Ryan Steer tries to slip it through once again. That was Clinton Hirwell wearing the number 5 jersey. I'll tell you an interesting story about that. Where's the number 5 on his back? Hails from Mitchell's Plain. That's his house number in the street where he lives. And he says that it reminds him of where he's come from and how far he could potentially get in life.
Inspiring story, that.
It is. Unlucky for Silent once again. It tracked him well, though, Mapanga.
They are looking to go to Josh Silent early, this time with the ball along the ground. I'm very interested in seeing how well he handles that, but they are looking to be a bit more direct than the men from Wits University, or those from the Varsity that is, of course, defending champions in Varsity Football, for those that aren't in the know.
Well, Wits, the team that they beat in the semi-finals last season, to actually book this their place in the final, which they eventually won.
Now, you mentioned that they are hitting their set pieces flat. The reason for that is the wind here in Johannesburg this afternoon turned evening. Granted, means if the ball does catch a lot of flight, a lot of air, it loses some of that zip. So they're hitting it flat to, of course, help deal with the conditions. It's interesting, both these sides in their dead ball situations have hit it very flat. And, young men that are thinking out there, you don't want to hang it in the air for the air to, deny the ball the necessary zip that makes life uncomfortable for defenders.
Oh, very astute. Yes, you're right. You float it up and it's going to just be carried away by the wind. Now, both of us can attest to that. It is blustering out there right now. It's been slightly strange weather. We're used to the cold, but the wind is howling and there's been rain on and off in Johannesburg the past couple of days. And then lightning two here and there. Relatively new to Johannesburg, but even I'm only used to seeing those classic half-felt storms during the summertime, really. Now Silent with his strength. What can he do here? It's a great turn and a setup for Sahail Ali. And then the ball just running away from Ethan Swartz. He retains it.
is still alive. Mpanga has work to do to try and curtail this. And Peterson has to just tip it over.
Loving the work from the big men here. Good work in what was a cross-come shot in the end, but the build-up all happens around the big man in Josh Silent. We saw that last week in the big man, the furthest man forward, and how teams play around the big man in varsity football this year. It seems to be a telling part, considering that they do have Graham Dorr on the other end on the attack to the home side in Wits. But Silent so far is doing a great job.
Corner number two for the visitors. Game flat, but this one floated up just a little bit more. So Hale Ali and kept in. That's not bad from the big defender, especially the feet, but then he made himself space and just harmlessly rolled it.
Tell you what, there were three players around the penalty spot. None of them made the run in towards that near post. They let him down then. Had they taken that gamble, just one of them, he would have met the ball then with the defense not quite shaped right to defend that near post area. They are growing in confidence and in touches of the UWC, and in fact getting that ball around that final third much more than the young men from Wits.
Go backwards with the throw. Calls for the ball here and receives it. On to Pereira. Almost loses out. Now he's up against the much larger Ali. And the pressure from Ali means that UWC have won a throw in an advanced position.
Closing down right from the front effectively.
That's good. Silent once again with his back to goal. Now to Ali. Lifts it in, and Silent once again gets something on it. Now, not a judge to have been a high boot. Cleanly taken and nicely done. But the ball through, trying to locate Graham Dorr, just not quite good enough. To his credit, Dorr having not received it, just still fighting back, trying to get it under his control. Once again, he had willing runners overlapping him. One of them, Ali. Now Silent gets it, and he's making good runs in behind the defense, so he can do it all. Back to goal.
Best player on the field right now. He's not the silkiest of movers out on that field. He looks
robust.
A bit sluggish. Yeah, robust, but
he hardly
loses the ball, and so much happens around him. He's almost a playmaker in how he's bringing his teammates into the game. And what was most impressive about this last attack is his movement of the ball after he had offloaded.
This time to the back post in the direction of Silent.
So, in an open play, they go towards Silent. In dead ball situations, everyone has gone towards Silent, barring one that was won by Ali. But everything happening around Silent, or Silent rather, I should say.
Now, Series. The ball just evades his teammate, Setti. Setti, a man who's played in the Nedbank Kiona team. 24 years of age, hails from Fort Beaufort, and did play against Kaiser Chiefs in that particular fixture. Look around the field, look at both teams. There's a fair degree of pedigree. It's been very evenly contested so far. It's an even split, 50-50. Although, if we're looking at the balance of play, UWC will be far happier with what they've been able to do.
Loving everything I've seen from varsity football this year. You mentioned men that have played for the Kiona team, also in the MDC. Last week we were talking about guys that had one or two from the NFD and Nedbank Cup as well, and the Motsepe League. And you're seeing it in the output, in the quality of play out there on that field, or on the fields we've seen so far in the games we've covered. The teams this year and the varsities that have qualified, they've seen lots of talk about true quality this year. Maybe the most competitive field is certainly showing in the quality of player.
It certainly is.
We were very, very complimentary of one striker last week whilst watching CUT. That was Kevin Chue. And now, in the same vein, very complimentary of another in Josh Silent, who right now has the ball at his feet, looking to make something happen. And he'll only get a throw in the end, but man oh man, he possesses a tremendous amount of strength.
I'll tell you, he's getting a headache. It's Rukato with the 12 on his back. He's struggling for strength. He matches him for size.
Now Ceres blocked. It will be a corner, corner number three.
Now, Rukato does match him for height, rather I should say, but when it comes to bulk, the battle is won by Josh Silent, so much so that he doesn't have to outrun him, he just has to protect the ball.
So much space here for Ceres. Nicely done. Now finally, that was a whip ball in rather than one of those flat balls. And the bobbling shot from the edge of the area is gobbled up by Brian Peterson. At them again. Here they come. Lala. And then from range, Peterson watched it all the way.
Tell you who won't be a happy man. Grant Karabo Mohudi, the coach of Wits University, he spoke of the need to focus on basics and, of course, have to be focused on attacking since they are the home team and they are also a side that lost their game last week. Other than the opening 5 minutes, we are seeing UWC begin to dominate this game over the last 10.
Absolutely are. Now Matonzi will have to come towards Ali, who does get his cross in. Yes, Matonzi, he needs to see a lot more of the ball. Moments earlier, it was his pass that was cut out, but he was calling for his teammates, saying, you need to create me some options. He's only 17 years old in his third year studying an LLB.
Doogie Howser.
It's 100% the law version. Yes. Now, from distance. And had Brent Lehman scrambling. Not bad at all, not bad at all. Tabane. Only 20 years of age. There's a school that Jeppy High School.
Surprised that you know Doogie Howser, but for any of the varsity students watching on and that aren't aware of Doogie Howser, back in the 80s, I believe it was, when I was still a very young man, there was a program on TV with a young kid doctor who was 17 and was a genius. He and his best friend, Vincent Delpino.
I mean, this young man, Matonzi, could be in court before he's even 20 years old. Could graduate before he's legally allowed to celebrate it with a glass of champagne.
I don't know if you have a lawyer yet, but Grant, now would be a good time to make friends with him.
Certainly would be, and he has said that he's focusing on both. He'll just see what comes. A man on the ball right now could pursue a career in football. Has played as high as the ABC Motsepe League. And of course, was last he was only 15 years old. Played last year in varsity football as a 16-year-old. Now UWC coming forward. Pavala. He's a man with plenty of pedigree as well. Speak about him in a moment. Got a very interesting backstory, as many of these young men on the field do.
It's also impressed me quite a bit here in what he's done in the midfield battle.
He's been one of those players who hasn't got that many touches, but when he has, it's his work off the ball as well. He likes to run channels, if I can say that, because he pulls men away from Josh Silence. And he's done it tremendously well. And 21 years of age, spent some time in England as an 18-year-old playing for Barnet FC. I'm not entirely sure what league they're in right now. I would imagine League 1 or League 2. And during that time, of course, if you remember, the coach of the team was Edgar Davids.
Yeah.
From about 2012 to 2014. That was the period that he was there. So he has been coached by Edgar Davids, player-manager at the time. And an interesting period in Barnet's history. I think when they first brought him on board, he was pushing 40, I think in his very, very late 30s, as a player manager. Left himself out of the match day squad for a game against Plymouth Argyle, which they lost 4-1. The next week he was like, I'm having none of this, absolutely none of this. Competed against Northampton. So you see Vitz attempt to come forward. They won that 4-0. Edgar Davids, man of the match.
What a player, and he's there. And of course, I do believe he has also spent some time as an analyst on your World of Champions in years gone by.
Just a little nudge from behind. And it does mean that Wits University have a chance to whip this one in, or should I rather say, just try and hit it flat in. The wind is still blowing tremendously hard. Foul count reflecting right now that University of Western Cape have committed just one more than Wits have.
A little bit different with that last set piece. That one caught a bit more air and gave Graham Dorr a bit of a chance. I think he got the slightest of touches onto it, but nothing convincing.
And here is the man who spent time with Barnett under Edgar Davids. Let's see what he can do. That's nice feet from him.
Intelligent.
Silent, just a little bit too much for him. But it goes all the way through, and then the header from distance.
Wasn't a bad header then from Ryan Steer with the ball into the area. Couldn't steer towards the post nearest to us here on this near side. But whilst we are playing on words here, need to say, the less we're seeing of Josh, the more Josh goes silent, the more we are seeing from Mpalala with the 12 on his back in driving this game. The University of Western Cape. So in the opening 15 minutes, it was Josh Silent driving this game. Now it's Mpalala, the more Josh goes silent.
Well, it means that they have plenty of, it doesn't matter who's on the ball, they have quality up there. But now worrying times for them. This is the third foul that they've committed. And this set piece, not out wide, it gives one of these young men a chance to try and direct this at goal, perhaps test Brent Lehman. This has a certain degree of pedigree about him, 23 years old, and had a chance to speak about some of the games he's been involved in. Well, shapes to direct it straight at goal, and then it's very cleverly disguised because it goes towards the head of Graham Dorr, and he's ever so close to squeezing that one in via his forehead.
Should be a little bit disappointed with himself. Then his movement was absolutely spot on. Again, you could tell it's from the training grounds, and they're angling them in towards the big young man. Then, and well, he'll be a little bit disappointed. He did well to cut in front of the defender, who still had a bit of contact on him, which may have put him off in the end. But still, you'll expect him to get that on target, especially since Wits University are struggling with the ball down on the ground. But from dead ball situations, they may be onto something with that big man.
Well, he's shone in varsity football in the past. Of course, they made it to the semi-finals last season. Graham Dorr was one of the men named in the team of the season for 2015. So we know that he's certainly capable of a lot. Just need to see him being slightly more accurate.
So far, it looks as though he is battling with Clinton Hurwell in the heart of that UWC defense in the aerial battles. Well, he's won the last two headers. That'll be encouraging for his confidence.
It certainly will be very encouraging. That was Luke Pereira just spreading it out wide. Now a chance. Turns it towards goal. Gilbert had to try and engineer something. The ball was slightly behind him. Couldn't get a lot of power on it. In the end, rather easily dealt with.
Did well with his improvisation, then his movement off the ball and cutting across the box diagonally was impressive. But like you say, then the ball was behind him. He improvised well to get a shot on target.
And that was a great ball over from Doogie Hauser. My word. He's coming to the fore slowly but surely. You know, I was waiting at the beginning of the game for him to get a few touches so we could speak about him. He's such an interesting young man. And he really wasn't seeing any of it, but he started to get a little bit more service and then in turn be able to provide service for others.
Getting them going forward.
Second Wits corner. So if the first was a tester, now we can really see what Graham Dorr can do. He's positioned in line with the back post, but isn't that close to goal. So imagine that he would try and make a run at the last minute. He seems the obvious option. Whipped in here. Does go in his direction. Doesn't come through to him. Comes through, in fact, to Roccato. He's made his way up from the back. And then, though he was relatively free, I think he got his direction slightly muddled. Wasn't quite sure where the goal was and wasn't able to locate it last minute as he was slightly turned away from it.
Josh Silent to drop back into a defensive area for the defending on that set piece. Roccato getting one up over him on that occasion. And
finally.
That'll be a bit of a boost for his confidence.
This is a good ball out to Gilbert. And he's content to just take the throw in here. Wins it off Clinton Hurwell. There is Hurwell once again. making up for not having dealt with it the first time.
Got a bit of a momentum switch here, Grant, over the last 5 minutes. It's this university that are, the driving seat and riding the wave, so to speak. Look, it's not wave upon wave of attack on our Brent Lehman, the man between the sticks for the University of Western Cape, but they are looking to, dominate in this game. They have to weather the storm for a good 15.
Well, for the University of Western Cape, off camera, just moments before, Ethan Swartz absolutely incensed by something. I think just by the fact that his teammates maybe taking their foot off the gas a little bit, urging them to go up forward. Here he is right now, gets it to Ahmad Seris.
That's different for the University of Western Cape, and what's seen them lose their momentum a bit is they aren't finding Josh Silent and using him quite as much as they were in the opening 15 when everything happened around him, in midfielders pushing forward towards him in the likes of Mbalala Ali and Nukwana. Now they are delaying in getting it to him, and by the time they get it forward, Wits University are pretty well set defensively in their defensive formation, so to speak.
Palala gets the benefit of referee calling for it to be played on there. It was actually really decently done. Just hit a first time around the corner, found a man. Now Ethan Swartz was mugged. A chance to move upfield for Wits. Showing a bit of haste here. That's nicely done. Really good. Can he get a cross in here? It's nothing more than a corner, but a show of intent there, Tabane. Series not happy with himself.
Was in a bit of trouble here on this near side with that run in towards that byline. There's that battle that's telling once again, number 12 up against number 22. 12, of course, being Rugato of Wits University up against Silent.
Now it comes in. A little bit more whip on that than we've seen so far today in the game.
Again, the ball angled in towards Rugato, so the battle between he and Silent was well and true. What's interesting about those two is they are battling on both sides of the field, whilst Rugato's a defender and had his hands full in the opening 15 in trying to deal with Silent being the furthest forward for the Western Cape. It's Rugato's turn to give Silent a handful when Silent has to defend him on set pieces and dead ball situations.
Show him what it's like, a bit of his own medicine. Was a crucial interception there. Wits had numbers. It was a little bit scrappy, but certainly if the home side had come away with it, it could have presented some kind of danger. Now Silent up upon the goalkeeper, and he's a lucky boy there, Brian Peterson. He was fouled, but he's lucky he was fouled because he was in all kinds of danger.
Any coach will see his heart in his throat when last line of defense is having to use his dribbling skills to get around a striker that's applying pressure. Nicely done by Silent.
Oh, he came charging up. Sometimes you're a little bit caught in two minds about what to do. I'd certainly be caught in two minds if there was a train coming towards me, 100 miles an hour.
Remember in the opening 2 minutes or so, Wits University had a moment where they were playing it back and again found themselves giving University of Western Cape forwards a bit of a carrot.
Here we go again.
To chase onto in the hope of winning it back.
They can't keep doing that.
They're dangling the carrot, so to speak, but yeah, it's mighty close. Now, Silent, outside of your picture, is having a word with his teammates and encouraging them to close down from the front. He's noted that they might be slightly overconfident, the home side.
So that particular game plan is very effective. Of course, it does require a tremendous amount of fitness on the part of everyone. Not just the men. Funnily enough, not just the men who are closing from the front, but everyone else in the team, because they need to fill those gaps. Now, that was good. It doesn't come to anything. And look at this, the last 5 minutes, the possession clearly in the favor of Wits. So have the last 10 minutes, and you know what, that's a really good reflection. The first 20 minutes 100% belong to UWC, and we still aren't seeing Wits do all that much with it.
Well, it's encouraging, and it'll be encouraging for them in that they, as we mentioned earlier, are riding the wave, so to speak, in the way of momentum. They adjusted well to that early pressure. And as much as one can fault University of Western Cape for what they aren't doing that worked in the opening 20, one also has to credit this university for being able to adjust and ensure that they cut out the avenues that were working so well for University of Western Cape.
Now that doesn't yield anything because that's a very, very poor ball forward from Martin Taylor. He's 24 years old. The school at King Edward. And there was an overlapping run, I believe it was, from Gilbert. And that could have been a promising situation, especially if you have Graham Dorr making tracks into the box. That's one thing that we haven't seen a tremendous amount of, is crosses from out wide from the University of Witwatersrand. And when you look at the way they've lined up, you look at the stature of the men up top, you'd imagine that they would be throwing those crosses in at every possible juncture. They aren't.
Has been a bit of a change in formation here from the University of Western Cape. We know Josh Silent is the furthest forward, but Suhail Ali with a 10 in his back, he started out wide on the right side with Mpalala with a 12, who's been impressive and gone cold a bit over the last 5 minutes, but he was playing behind the striker. Those two have swapped, and not sure if that's maybe the reason for why they are maybe struggling now to find those moments to cause some discomfort to that Wits University defense. But I'll tell you what, Ali's not seen the ball all that much since he's moved into a more central position. There he is now.
I think he'll be hoping that when he does, on the occasion that he does see the ball, that he can do something more telling with it. But you're right, if he's not going to get an awful lot of service, he can't really manufacture anything. Still marveling at the stature of those two, Silent and Ali. You're right, they are built like rugby players. If I had to take a guess, is this a football player from Cape Town, or is he the winger for the Crusaders? I would be more inclined to say the
Crusaders.
Latter. Yeah.
For both of them.
Silent, but more like a centre. Now, Witz trying once again to play out from the back. Very dangerous, they're being closed down. There they come, UWC. Silent. Oh, it looked good. It looked promising. Could tell what he was trying to do.
Well defended, exceptionally well defended. Then he watched the ball and not the man, and that's the reason why he wasn't lost chasing the wind rather than finding the ball and clearing it. He was calm as well, which was so impressive.
A series. Silent wants it to his feet. He's calling for it. That's good. Kalala to Ali to Silent. Lost.
It's twice now his ball control or his first touch has let him down, Silent. That's something he was doing so well then, in using his body to shield the ball in the opening 15-20 minutes. It's
certainly
something
was
he needs to improve on now.
Well, that was an impressive escape there, I must say, from Witz. But I wanted to mention to you just previously, as Graham Dawes' touch lets him down, that it's often what we see. There's no plan B. You would imagine Witz's plan A is to play out from the back. It isn't working. It worked there, yes, but let's say the two, three previous occasions, they've been closed down tremendously well by UWC. It's presented real opportunities to them. However, the home side persist.
What I'd like to see them do more is that maybe push up a little bit early towards door. And one avenue not working, you try a plan B, as you
100%.
Do say, and well, say play it long towards door, see if you can play with his back to goal. I'd like to see that more from the big man. Right now there's a bit of a mismatch in the man keeping tabs on him, of course, in Akeen and Davis. Huge mismatch, that ball in towards them. Davis wins it,
yeah.
So route one might not work.
Maybe not.
Jokingly.
Well, Davis has played as high as the ABC Motsepe League for Grassy Park. He's not the only one. In fact, Ryan Steer in the midfield also has turned down for Grassy Park in the past.
I like the fact that Mpalala then didn't hold on to it for too long. He had a few good moments, you remember, about 10 or so minutes ago, and then I felt personally then he began to hold on to it too long. With his confidence growing, he's gone back to the basics and better with the movement that is around him, which was impressive then from Eaton Swartz.
Swartz came charging in there. He has to pace he was going at, wasn't able to control the ball. UWC. You see, they are far happier to find a route upfield. And very surprisingly, Palala's touch letting him down. We haven't seen much of that.
You mentioned that touch. It's something they were able to do so well in the opening moments. He and Silent, with the ability to hold on to the ball, numbers pushed forward, and they were able to create promising moments. And with that first touch now vacating both of them, got a bit of a problem in getting into good attacking positions.
Edgar Davis won't be particularly impressed. He'll be saying at 43, I still have a better touch than that.
Swapped again, have those two. Ali back wide on the left side with Palala moving into a central position behind Silent. Let's see if there'll be an improvement from a UWC perspective now that they've gone back to what worked for them.
It's always interesting, Cizwe, to speak about what's happening off camera, and UWC are coming forward here, but still coming forward. Oh, this could be it. Oh. This could be the opener. What a turn. My word. Now, the ref has ruled in favor of the goalkeeper. Kukwanda, what a fantastic turn by him.
Well, there was the initial touch that was impressive and brilliant from Palala. That was followed up by this turn from Nukwana then. Brilliant in both regards, magical from both men. What, of course, thwarted them was brave goalkeeping in the end. Extremely brave. When that defense was opened up by those brilliant touches, the goalkeeper had to be brave, of course, in ensuring there wasn't a clear-cut chance for Nungwana, who's now suffered a bit of an injury from those two coming together. I'll tell you what, this man here timed that movement off that line and needs to get the big up we're seeing from Apanga then, the captain of this first side. They were in trouble. They were outwitted and were in all sorts of trouble until he stepped up to the rescue.
Perhaps he's having words about the shape of the defense. He's had to make 5 saves already today. So quite a lot of work for him in the opening. We haven't even reached 40 minutes yet. Now, this is worrying. Kukwanda, limping off. Unsure of exactly where he's clutching, whether it was something pulled or whether he took a knock. He seems to be clutching at his groin.
Yeah. In the thigh looks to be the problem then. Perhaps, hoping he hasn't pulled a muscle. There's a sign.
Well, he's
pulled
he's
something,
done. Yeah. He's done.
Remember, in under 17, out of great college some years ago, when I was still a youngster, pulling that muscle then on the inside of the thigh is one of the most painful experiences. Never pulled one before until that particular day. I was about 17, and when it did go, it went, and it was a shock. Felt like I was being shot or stabbed in the thigh. Movement is a problem, and of course, if I remember right, I had to take a good month or so off. So for Nungwana, we're hoping it's not too serious. A muscle being pulled off of the bone, so to speak.
Well, he knew something,
yeah.
Didn't he?
Yeah, and he may have to miss a few weeks here, depending on the seriousness of it, which may be a concern for UWC.
Interestingly enough, it doesn't look like they're going to make the sub yet, as Ali picks it up. Can't locate anyone. Pereira hacks it clear. This time they're not going to try and play out from the back. He is being treated by Damon Haster, and physiotherapist initially signaled for a sub to take place immediately, and it seems like it will have to.
Keep in mind, the subs aren't warming up necessarily in the first half, so they have to quickly get him warmed up, the man that will be shortly coming on.
Now down to 10 men, they keep attacking, and there's a rash challenge from Ali.
Now, there's for many of you watching on and wondering, Grant, here about UWC defending champions. We haven't seen much of them, and Vets, of course, semi-finalists last year, and we haven't seen the very best from them. They're two sides that have met on a couple of occasions and played a few draws, and 3 draws in fact in the last year, I believe it is, and 70% of a new squad for Wits, so it's not necessarily the same squad as last year, whilst for UWC, 16 of their 28 players are first-year students and are new to the squad as well, with some of their players having graduated, others received scholarships, we heard as well.
Well, bodes well for the future, but it doesn't necessarily mean that they will do so well or be able to retain their title this time around. Now, real chance, Wits scuffed. That wasn't good enough from Gilbert, not by a long shot.
Again, his movement off the ball is impressive. They're not getting it up to the attacking players all too often, but every now and then he looks maybe the, well, most impressive point in attack here, in that he's pulled off two shots now with the movement of the ball. One was on target and the other went disappointingly wide, which was the last.
Giovanni Gafur makes his way onto the field, a 19-year-old from Settlers High School, looking to make an impact. Listed amongst his other talents, cricket, table tennis, swimming, so he's a sportsman through and through. Oh, left by Matonzi. In error, it must be said, because Palala now coming forward. Really well done. Shoots it across and Josh Silent trying to arrive at the near post. Can't get to it.
As soon as he got the ball out on that far side, Palala was thinking, take on the defender. He did so impressively. Nothing wrong with the drilling of the ball in towards that near post, hoping for maybe one of your teammates taking a gamble or a defensive error. But positive from him, he's now become possibly the most influential player, much less of Silent, of course, we're seeing now. And it's through no fault of his own. They just aren't pinging it towards him as often as they were in the opening 20.
Well, this is good from Gilbert. He made the mistake earlier with his shot that wasn't quite up to scratch and loses out once again. To his credit, still battling away. Now UWC. Patient. Palala. Oh, that's really well done. Silent up ahead, back to goal. Turns it on to Palala. Well, we have some interesting spectators here. St. David's High School. Mm. They've done a great thing here. They've sent all of their football players.
Yeah, first team.
To watch the game, yeah.
Yeah, the A team, rather.
A team of every respective age group, yeah.
First team under 16, under 14.
I don't think they were allowed to miss any school. Maybe the last period. They were here quite early.
Yeah.
But yeah, certainly something that will be very enjoyable and something that they can learn from. I think it must be said that watching live football is very different from watching it on TV, and perhaps not all of these boys would have seen that much live football, and there's a lot that can be learned, especially sitting with your coach. He can show you. Look what the defense is doing right now. You don't see that on camera. Mm. There's a very valuable outing for these young men. The lone vuvuzela that you can hear in the crowd is being is being utilized by one of them.
People still have those?
Getting into the spirit, well, getting into the spirit of 6 years ago. That's a good touch from Graham Dorr. Now he's starting to see what he's capable of, and he just overplays there.
He was looking for the nutmeg.
He's trying to go through Ali's legs.
Yeah. He's got game with the ball at his feet as well. For those of you that may not have noted, for the big man, expecting maybe a Akumantarakis type of player. Now, we're seeing big men here that are very intelligent. You mentioned Treu from CUT. We saw last week, man of the match in the game out at four here. We've seen Silent when he's at his best. He's anything but Silent. For UWC, and Dorr showing some touches and moments as well. Here he is.
Finally choosing to go a little longer. Now Dorr brought down. It was a clean tackle. It was Pereira who played that ball upfield. Often there's a reluctance to play the longer balls in South African football, and he's happy to utilize it when he deems it to be appropriate. It was appropriate there. I think they need to see just a little bit more of that.
I think this first half will be a bit of a lesson for the young men from St. David's that are watching on here, for all of their coaches, and seeing big men and the ability to hold on and the ability of the team to support them in playing to their strengths, and also the adjustment from Wits opening 20 minutes, if you weren't with us, it was a UWC that were in the driving seat. Wits then adjusted around 25 minutes, and a very even half we've seen between both these sides. And running up my thoughts of this first half, Grant.
Well, it has been a very good first half, even though it hasn't yielded goals. Perhaps the only one negative point is that Kokwanda has had to be withdrawn, and having seen him come past the commentary box and taken into the tunnel, I can tell you that he's clutching his face in agony. And yeah, it doesn't look good for him, as you mentioned. Something like that happens. Don't expect to be coming back all too soon. So we're past the 1 minute of the referee's discretionary time, and he calls an end to it. Well, it's been a game of stages, a stage where UWC were well in the ascendancy through Josh Silent. He was the focal point of everything good that was happening for them. Slowly his influence began to wane, and Kaiser Mapanga perhaps getting the upper hand over him. The likes of Luke Pereira choosing to be a little bit more pragmatic in the midfield than they had been previously. It means it's still deadlocked here at the Bidvest Stadium. Wits 0, UWC 0.
Well, it's been a half of plenty of endeavour on either side as the UWC tried to have a go at Wits University, but after 45 minutes, no goals as yet. But it will be the away side that will feel a little more comfortable with how their first half went. They asked a bit more questions than the home side, but as of yet, they are yet to score a goal, as are Wits as well. But UWC did, of course, lose a player just before the end of the half due to a groin injury, so maybe that dampened their first half a little bit. After this short break, we're going to have a look at the moments that headline the first half as the UWC take on Wits University.
We haven't seen anything hit the back of the net yet. It's goalless in Johannesburg between Wits and UWC, but that doesn't mean that we have